So, I'm Quin.
Hi, I'm Selene.
And we just saw 50 Shades Darker.
Dun dun dun.
And I actually enjoyed it more than the first one. And I didn't drink this time because the movie theater was not serving alcohol yet.
We were not properly lubricated for this movie.
Yeah, no, we weren't. So before we talk about the second one, I want to talk about the first one just really briefly because you were not with me. Went in the last review, my friend Jen was with me and I wasn't able to visit her this time, so my buddy Celine came with me and yeah, so I made her have to watch the first one.
All by myself.
Yeah, all by yourself. So what did you think of the first one?
Oh God, it was really painful actually. And I was properly lubricated for that movie.
Yeah.
It was a poorly done, I guess the best thing I can say about it was that it was a poorly done movie of a poorly done book.
Yeah.
So at least it was consistent.
You didn't read the books though.
No. Yeah. No, yeah. I didn't. I read the books.
I read all three of them. It was quite a few years ago though, so, these things that we do. But I do want to say that after watching the second one, they really did water down like Christian's terribleness. kind of the same way they did with Humbert Humbert in the Lolita movies. Like, in the books, he's terrible. He's, just not a good person. While in the movies, in the 60s version and the 97 version, he's very sympathetic. And that's kind of what they do with Christian in both these movies, I feel like.
I think more so in the second one than the first one.
Yeah, because he gets some backstory. We get, when it first starts, it opens up with, his sad childhood. Oh, no.
Yeah, not bad. If you don't have a flashback, I don't know. Well, I wonder if maybe they made a little extra effort in this movie to make him seem more sympathetic because of maybe a bit of public backlash from his character being so awful.
Yeah. I think the book Gray coming out and his point of view didn't exactly help. So that was another thing that I was telling you about when we didn't even know when the movie was coming out. We thought it was coming out the weekend after Valentine's Day. When the first movie came out, there was so much advertising. There was, 50 Shades of Wine, 50 Shades Benoit balls.
Benoit balls.
Balls. 50 Shades, t-shirts and all this stuff. And this one, there was, nothing.
They probably oversaturated the market for 50 Shades of blah, and no, it's not worth it again.
Yeah. So, for this one, they were definitely trying to make him seem more sympathetic.
Did it work?
I don't know.
I think they're both equally awful now, rather than one be really awful and the other one be just sad. I think they're both awful people now.
Yeah, they're both terrible. And that's one thing more that I did kind of like about this one. The second one is that Anna has more of a backbone in this. So what's happened now is they were split up, because they split up in the last movie, and because, he hit her and got off on it, and she didn't like that. So. Even though she's the one that asked to see how bad it could get.
He told her all the way along.
He told her,
I got it off.
She's kind of got flip-flops back and forth with this, which is, she didn't really do that so much in the books, if I remember correctly. She's just no, this stuff is terrible. How could you do this? But in the movie, she's kind of well, this is awful, but you could spank me.
You're broken, and you should feel bad about what you like, but also
But let's do this a little bit. Yeah, it is... It kind of goes back and forth. So this is them getting back together and no more rules.
No more punishments.
But she still has to do everything that he says and he has to do everything that she wants. And it's very just, I don't know what they were trying to do. I mean, E.L. James got more creative control this time. So, and it was just a mess.
Yeah.
This is kind of how the movie goes. Nothing happens, and they're having sex again. Nothing happens, they're having sex again. I will say, though, that the sex scenes in this one were a lot hotter, in my opinion. The music was kind of distracting. The score is a little bit too loud every time they're gonna have sex.
Probably make it for the crappy dialogue
in the rest of the movie. Yeah, definitely, definitely. But I will admit, you know, like the one with the spreader bar.
Yeah.
That was good.
And he does go down on her quite a bit.
He does. He didn't go down on her that much in the books. I think I mentioned that to you during the movie. I was like, geez, he's going down on her a lot. I felt so bad for the people. There was a lot more people in the theater than we expected, so we couldn't really, you know, Mystery Science Theater 3000 things it too much.
There was actually less people than I thought. That's why I went and bought my ticket early, because I was so afraid that it was going to sell out. I don't know why. But
it was the day after Valentine's. Everybody saw it last night. But yeah, no, there were less people than you thought and more people than I thought.
But either way, we were a little rude.
Yeah, we were totally being rude.
Like, hindsight, when we were picking our seat, we probably should have gone to like the opposite end of the row because there were less people, but it was fine.
Laughing hysterically at moments.
Thanks.
Yeah, thanks. So there's okay, let's get this on track. So they're getting back together, they're trying to figure out how they want to do this relationship. Anna's got a new job with a sleazy boss. Ooh, and they tried so hard to make this guy like the villain, you know, worse than Christian, which I thought was pretty hilarious. The actor was really adorable too. Like he was super cute.
He looks like he would have played the bad boy on like a CW teen show.
Yes.
So like he's that, not quite actually bad boy, but kind of that little, like my hair's a little scruffy kind of bad boy.
Yeah, with a little stubble. And his name was Hyde, by the way.
Look,
we're just hitting the nail on the head, right?
Jack Hyde. Yeah. Not Jekyll, Jack Hyde.
Yeah, we're really, really slapping going for
it. That one. Not as bad as later on when you see Jack slapping you in the face with the bad boy.
In this movie, we also see Christian Grey's rapist, or woman who brought him into the kink world, Mrs. Robinson. Once again referencing a better movie.
It's like name dropping in movies when you reference
they tried
movies.
So hard in this one. But yeah, we finally saw her because he mentions her in the first movie, if I remember correctly. And we see her this time, and it's really uncomfortable because they give it like the, oh, it's another relationship kind of thing in the book. Like, she rapes him when he was 15 in the books. Like, this is the canon in the books. And, you just saw the first one, so they mentioned it in the first one. Yeah. So, when I read the book, I was, like, really upset that, like, Anna, because, you know, it's in Anna's head in the first book, and she's, like, seems more upset that, like, oh, Miss Robinson is the other woman. And it was just really disgusting. While one good thing about this movie is that Anna, like, you know, she calls her out on being disgusting. She's like, no, you abused him. Like, you should not be in his life anymore. And I was kind of like, oh, damn, movie Anna's got a backbone and has some more brains in her head. Like, well done.
Even Christian talks about her like, oh, well, we're not together anymore. We're just friends. We're just friends. And Mrs. Robinson continues with this narrative of, oh, you're not good enough for him. You're not going to understand him the way I do. So there's obviously like three different perceptions of the same relationship. And Anna's is probably a little bit more unbiased in that situation.
Yeah, it's pretty creepy. Jumping ahead a little bit, though, the Mrs. Robinson character actually turns out to be friends of Christian's adoptive mom, who I really love the actress that plays her.
She wore a couple sexy mom dresses.
She did.
Nice, like a backless kind of thing.
I can't remember what her name is. Like her.
She's got one of those faces.
She was the crazy religious lady in the mist. Like, I was like, I feel like if she had been that lady as this character, that would have been fun.
But, and if you haven't seen The Mist, you need to go watch
The Mist. Yeah, you should go see The Mist. See, we're just, it makes me want to see other movies as well.
It adds credibility to this video for name dropping other movies.
Exactly. Something that I thought the book did better, I can't believe I'm going to say that, but yeah, the book did better when Christian's adoptive mom finds out that her friend has been fucking her son for a long time. Like, she slaps her. And, you know, I remembered in the book, like, it ended up being a way bigger deal, and, like, more people saw this, so Mrs. Robinson was, like, humiliated in front of all these people at this party. But in the movie, it was like, oh, Anna just throws, you know, what, alcohol or whatever in her face. It didn't, see, I think it was more water. She didn't really react. If it had been alcohol, she would have been like, ah! But anyway, like, it was a bigger scene in the book, and so I was a little disappointed to see that it wasn't as big of a scene, but, you know, she left.
Well, that would have been a perfect opportunity for someone other than the main characters to have a dramatic moment for their characters, and everyone just kind of seems like the peripheral characters.
It's very, like, claustrophobic. It's just about the two of them, which I guess that's the point, but in a movie it should be more, I think.
Yeah, I mean, I get doing that as an artistic choice in the first one to kind of emphasize the isolationism that mm-hmm. Christian's trying to instill in Anna with a non-disclosure agreement mm-hmm. and everything, but in this one, their family is there so often. There's so much social gatherings, so isolating them for this confrontation doesn't seem like a good choice.
That's a good thing. I'm trying to think what else happens, because a lot of, like I said earlier, a lot of stuff doesn't happen. Like, it's just a lot of, oh, this happens, and they're having sex again.
There's the ex.
The ex, yeah, the ex-sub of Christian's makes an appearance, and in the trailer, it makes it seem a lot more exciting, but it's just kind of like, oh, hey, there's a girl watching you. Who is that?
It's probably because, okay, like, they made it sound like she was the central conflict of the movie, but it turns out that there really was no central conflict of the movie.
No, it was bad writing. But, you know, we already know that, like, there's been enough jokes made about this. But you mentioned when we were watching that scene for you. It was kind of sad. Do you want to?
Yeah, like, kind of the climax of that whole subplot, the girls following Anna around mm-hmm. and, like, being all creepy and junk. And then Christian explains that she's a former sub of his who was going through a bad time and whatever. And so there's a final confrontation. He beefs up security around Anna, and then Anna stupidly goes up to her own apartment alone. Like, we didn't see this coming. And the girl's there waiting with a gun. And she's doing the whole, oh, what do you have that I don't have?
Bangs.
I love her bangs. She looks exactly like the actress who plays Anna, down to, like, the eye color. And she says, like, what do you have that I don't have? And the only thing she does have is bangs.
Yes.
And Quinn says that, and I almost died laughing. And, like, it was hysterical. So it's now become a thing. And so Christian comes up and, like, just goes over to the girl and, like, gets her attention and, like, does the whole intense eye contact, like, takes the gun, and then tells her to kneel, and she drops to her knees, and he subdues her by petting her hair and everything, and gets Anna out, and it broke my heart, because I've known people who have been in bad DS relationships where there was a lot of protocols and even some Pavlovian conditioning involved in their relationship, so that, like, the Dom would make a hand gesture and she would immediately fall to her knees into a position.
Wow.
And these things were so ingrained from repetition and from the conditioning that they would still be triggers years later. And it was so hard to get rid of those conditioning in her head. And it was just, it brought back thoughts about those, my friends who have had to deal with that kind of a thing when a relationship that strongly has just ended or has been abusive. And it was very sad to see that, but it's probably the most genuine moment of these entire movies thus far, and it was only because I picked up on it from my past experiences, but it was really interesting.
So there was actually a deep moment in this, like, mm-hmm. I just, like, you know, when I read the books, it didn't really hit me like that, just because I didn't have that kind of, haven't been around, you mm-hmm. know, that kind of situation.
It's something that's not really talked about very often, as we talk about the importance of, when you're going into a power exchange relationship, building trust and building these kind of protocols, but oftentimes people don't talk about what to do when they're not there anymore, because breakups are so hard as they are. But if you have all this conditioning or protocols involved, and then they're just gone one minute, it can be very traumatic. Mm-hmm. And it's something that's just not talked about very often.
So do you think that was handled, even though this movie is ridiculous and the series is ridiculous, do you think that scene or everything, the seriousness of it was handled okay, or?
I liked the seriousness of it because it did bring a level of believability into the role. If you again, it would have been a moment that was completely lost if you haven't been through that kind of a context. Mm-hmm. However, personally for me, it made me hate Christian even more because it means that not only is he shitty about getting into the DS relationships, as we spent an hour and 45 minutes in the first movie scene,
right.
But he obviously can't end them well either.
Yeah.
Because this girl has such trauma. And, I mean, I'm glad she's getting the help that she needs through a mental health facility, mm-hmm. but it makes me hate Christian all the more. He says he has experience with a lot of things, like helicopter piloting, but
he's only 27. He's only 27. Got a lot of problems.
Speaking of helicopters.
Charlie Tango. No, that's what it was called in the books. Like, there's a running joke, and they talk about the helicopter Charlie Tango. It's really dumb. But the submissive pose and everything that made. Mm. So they did that. So after. Let's see. After the ex girlfriend gets taken, or ex sub, sorry, gets taken away. When is he falls down, Anna's gonna leave, or she's like, I just need time to think, because it was when he wanted to take things more serious, to move in, yeah, he wants Anna to move in, I believe, and it was either after wanting to move in, or she wanted to go to New York.
I think it was right after the part with the ex-sub, because she's there, and, like, she walked around for, like, 3 hours.
That's right, she got upset, yeah, and she left, because Anna needed some time to think, and so she finally comes back, and Christian's just like, where the fuck were you, and all that. And then she's about to leave, I think, and then I took it this way in the book and in the movie. I really like to hear your opinion, but when he sits, like, just plops down and does that, like, sub pose, mm-hmm. to me, that seemed extremely, like, just, like, I'm not getting my way. Like, even though she just went through that experience seeing the ex-sub and how important that scene was, to me, it seemed like he was just pouting to get his way. What did you feel like that scene was?
I read it totally different.
Yeah?
Because I could see how that, because he did just kind of flop. Mm-hmm. But he was in the exact same pose that his ex-sub had been in the previous scene, mm-hmm. which is obviously something that he learned from potentially Mrs. Robinson mm-hmm. as a begging sort of supplication kind of gesture that he passed along to his sub. Mm-hmm. Personally, I read him, even corrects her in that scene. He says, I'm not a dominant, I'm a sadist. Mm-hmm. Which I actually completely believe, mm-hmm. because he obviously can't maintain a healthy dominance 24/7.
Right.
He likes to hurt people. Therefore, he's a sadist. He should be a top, not a dominant.
Uh-huh.
But it does seem like, especially when he's begging Anna to stay and all about this, that those were latent behaviors that were learned from when he was 15 with Mrs. Robinson as how to beg, how to properly ask for what he wants, which is her to stay in this situation. And mm-hmm. if that was their dynamic, where she was his dominant, Mrs. Robinson was his dominant, he was the sub, that could have been their protocol of how to ask for things, that he passed that pose along to his sub. So I took it as his most immediate way of how to beg for what I want, because he's probably not had to do that very often in his adult life mm-hmm. since Mrs. Robinson. So that's how I took it. He did kind of flop.
Yeah. That's really interesting. I like it. I think there's a lot of good, that's not really the right word. It's definitely more to think about. Like, I was going to this movie just really excited for the train wreck that it was going to be. Because I'd heard that, like, E.L. James and her husband, I believe, had creative control over the screenplay for this one, so it was going to be more like the books, which it was. It was more like the book than the first one was, and, you know, it's awkward, and there's, like, all this ridiculous baggage with this movie, and you know how, like, the actor and the actress, they don't like each other, and you can tell that they're uncomfortable, but I did enjoy seeing this one more than the first one. I think it's also because we have realized that it's kind of a joke, like, that it's not, like, when the first one came out, yeah, like, you know, I took it kind of seriously, like, I thought it was gonna, like, really hurt people, and, like, when I, you know, like, you just get worried about, this kind of thing, and people like can get hurt, and you read things or you hear things about people getting hurt trying this other stuff, and like abusive people like trying to take like, oh, I'm a dominant, I'm gonna play this role and get all these women. You know, that happens, but it, you know, it's not a movie's fault, it's not a book's fault. There's gonna be bad people out there, but like, just if it gets you hot, if it gets you off, that's awesome. But you know, there's, as far as movies goes, there's better movies. But this one definitely was not as bad as the first one. I actually did enjoy it more. And I didn't have alcohol this time.
You know, they didn't say 50 shades of anything.
50 shades of fuck.
They didn't say that.
They did say kinky fuckery.
They did say kinky fuckery.
Okay, so like they're in bed together and they're having like this little sweet moment. And she's like, oh, we're being all sweet. And then you're gonna do some kinky fuckery. And all he's doing is like kissing her stomach. And that's kinky fuckery.
Apparently.
So, yeah, so... Wow, this review is just off the rails, isn't it? So he asks her to marry him. They've been together for, well, according to the books, like, they've been together 5 weeks. They were broken up 2 days, so there's two between each movie. 1 and 2, 2 days. 2 days.
And that's what upset me about the first one. Well, there's a lot of stuff that upset me about the first one, to be honest. But, like, the most compelling scene was the scene where he shows her how bad it can be, and he hits her 6 times with a belt. And then, you know, she freaks out and all of that. That was an actual decent scene, as far as all the other scenes that had preceded it. That actually felt like a genuine scene. And then they fucking ruin it by putting a montage after. Like, they could have ended it. Like, she slams the door, that's the end. And I would have respected that artistic choice.
They did. Because it's like the pain scene, and then it's the montage, and then it's Christian, Anna, elevator.
Yep. And then they did a montage where she's crying a lot, and he's working out a lot. Seriously, that like, go watch it again. But
that,
yeah.
That might have been the... What did you... Was that the DVD or Blu-ray or some other release?
Because
I don't know if that was the theater release.
It may not have been.
In the end, I don't recall.
I don't know. He pirated it, so I'm not sure.
Okay.
No. Pay for your movies, guys.
That's terrible.
So that may have been the director's cut. So
okay,
that was a good cut. Then he said they should have cut that out.
So. Yeah, I'm trying to think what else is there to add, really?
Okay, the helicopter scene was completely
unnecessary. Helicopter scene, yeah, we didn't need the helicopter scene. Like, because the helicopter crashes, and everybody's like, oh no, he's gone. And I know this review seems really disjointed, and we're kind of all over the place, but that's how the movie is. Like, there's no narrative, there's no beginning, middle, and end. It's just, here's a scene, here's sex. Here's a scene, here's sex.
With some fights sprinkled
with
in.
Some fighting, yeah. let's see, Mrs. Jones was in this one. She was not in, even though she, in the books, she's in the first one, and she does things in the first one.
Oh,
the housekeeper, yeah.
She was nice.
She's in this one, yeah. There's also Benoit Balls.
Benoit Balls. Balls. You also meet the sister.
You meet?
She actually does stuff.
Yes, Mia.
Jose's in there for random reasons.
Jose is in, yes, Jose made an appearance again, and for some reason is at Christian's house.
Yeah, lots of Christian Grey family functions include Jose. For some
apparently,
reason.
Yeah. And Jose was the one who supposedly almost was gonna rape her, at least that's the way Christian acted in the this one.
Yeah,
the last one, sorry.
At the very beginning the whole thing started with like an art show that he surprised Anna. Jose surprised Anna with an art show that is six
all
pictures
Anna.
Of her.
And then Christian buys them all and he's like, I don't want people gawking at you. Like,
come
on. Oh, I remember. So okay, I remember what I was gonna ask something. Okay, I don't know if you've ever done this, but I don't know if this is what I'm gonna talk about. Is it little ears maybe? I might have to put this as not safe for work content or something. But the Benoit balls, like, I don't have an experience with those. Was it an accurate portrayal of Benoit balls?
No.
Yeah, like, the whole, like, you're not putting those in my butt, that was kind of adorable. Like, he's holding them up, and you've got these little metal balls that are attached with this little string, and I'm just like...
Wasn't there a whole, like, contract where they actually had, like, butt plugs, nipple clamps, fisting?
Yeah, there's no contracts in
how
this
was,
one.
But how is Benoit balls not on there?
I don't know, but...
She didn't Google it?
So it was an accurate... Like, yeah, she used to be an English major.
What's a butt
plug? What are butt plugs? From the first one? Oh my god, that was so great. But...
I laughed so hard. Yeah, the Benoit balls, not...
Is it, was
no.
it, yeah.
No.
It was interesting. It was very interesting that every time they were around his family was when Christian Grey got the most revved up. So, which we already know he definitely has some mommy issues.
You mean the crack whore?
The crack whore. Yeah, like they didn't, I did like about the movie versus the book is that he didn't constantly call his birth mother a crack whore like he did in the books. So score one for the movie.
They also didn't do, we talked about this on the way back, they didn't like actually go, hey, you look like my mom. That's why I want to hit you.
That's why I want to beat you because you look like my mom. Yeah, like that's the thing that's in the books, and it's just
yeah. I mean, he mentions it, but like as like a aside kind of thing.
Yeah.
Like I've observed this pattern about myself, and I'm attracted to women who look like my mom, as opposed to that's why I want to hit you.
Yeah, like I mentioned earlier, they definitely soften him and make him not as much of a monster. I think monster's kind of a strong word, but he's... The thing is, like, that I enjoy about the movies, even though these movies are terrible, but book versus movie, come on, that Anna does have more of a backbone, but she also manipulates him just as much as Christian manipulates her. And, like, it is not all him. She's just as... These are not good people. Kinky sex stuff aside, they're not good people. Like, they need some help.
They both need therapy.
Yeah, they do.
Pretty bad. But yeah, no, they're both awful. But at least within the confines of their relationship, they're only harming each other.
Yeah.
This isn't like Wuthering Heights nonsense where they're just bringing everybody into it and just destroying them.
Yeah, that's good. But you know, the third one, we gotta see the third one together, I think, you know.
50
Shades Freed. I remember when I read the books, I thought I was like in the middle of book three, I was like, maybe she's gonna be free of him. Spoilers.
It's not. Well, I was sitting there, I'm like, hey, this was like, I mean, they got engaged, and then they put the giant ass, you know,
fucking rock.
Giant fucking rock. There's fireworks, and everybody's happy, and they're engaged. Oh, and then, I'm like, hey, maybe we don't have to have a third one.
Then in the shadows. Dun, dun, dun. CW bad boy Jack Hyde in his leather jacket and stubble and a cigarette.
Which there burns through
burns
Christian's
a picture
face.
Of Christian's face. For some reason, he has a family photo of them.
Yeah. But they really just layered on
they
the
were
WB
trying so
team
hard.
Bad boy.
Oh, yeah.
All over
and
that.
It was hilarious. It was.
Well, Christian got him fired, so he was kind of mad about that.
Yeah, he just took over his company for nothing. Like I said, this timeline is all over the place. I apologize. It's not the best, you know, review, but it's not the best. The movie is just kind of, here we go, we got this plot and this plot and this plot and this plot, so.
Yeah, and none of which added up to a good movie, though.
I did really enjoy this, though, so it's fun. I'm glad we got to go together.
Yes, I would not have seen it otherwise, and yet, like you said, the reason I was so against reading the books or watching the movies was just because it was so terrible, I was so angry. I saw a time hop on my Facebook where I was decrying it from 2014.
Like, yeah, like, don't see this movie. Terrible, no, it's like, no go like, see it.
Please do.
Have a laugh. It's
but go after 6:15 because apparently the movie theater bar doesn't open until 6:15.
Yes.
And we were there before that.
Yeah. Let's see. I'm sure maybe like Riff Trax will probably come out with it. Like I want to see a Riff Trax of this. Or we could just do something similar. That would be
Rich
funny.
For me.
I would love that.
I don't know if we can do all, if we like, want to do that when
the
third
could do
one comes
movie.
Out.
Yeah, we should totally figure out how to do that.
Definitely.
Yeah. So, Selene, where can we find you if people want to see more of you on the internet?
Oh, I'm on the Twitter machine.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll put your link in the description.
Yep.
You want?
Selene Le Banff. Because that's how long I made that Twitter was when Banff was still a thing.
That's cool. Sometimes there's adult content there, so please be careful. And do you wanna talk about anything that you might be working on with any certain cosplay amazing people, or do you not want to talk about that?
No. I'm planning some projects.
Nice.
Planning some projects. I don't like going to so too many specifics.
Oh, okay. That's exciting. Well, just
follow me on Twitter. You
follow me on the tweets. And you can follow me on the Twitter at @ThatMissQuinn. Quinn with one N. Please be careful. There's a lot of adult things on there, so
but
18 only. Yes, it's very fun. And yeah, I think we're gonna have to watch more movies together.
Yeah, this needs to be a thing. We were discussing on the car.
All right, until next time.
Bye.